Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel for episode 19 of Bumbling Through Birthright. If you're new here or not caught up, make sure you do check out the playlist that I have for this, or for the last episode, just check the link down below. But basically, at the end of last session, we had got back to Hollingholmen from Dantir Island, and we had a couple problems that were waiting for us at the castle that we had to deal with. For this session, there were again 5 player characters: Roz, Brindis, Rainier, Val, and Renolfer being replaced by Jan. So we started out the session and we were still in the castle because we had a few other things we needed to deal with. Not petitioners, thank God, because Brindis hates them, but because the people in Levica had petitioned us to sue for peace with the Bloodskull Barony, and we decided that, you know what, maybe we'll ask them, because then if they then are not peaceful, we can beat them up and we can say we tried. We decided to set up a commission to figure out how we could even talk to them and ask them for peace, right? Seems like a good idea. And it was kind of a, we'll push this off and then we won't have to deal about it for a while. But our government is kind of effective, so we already have a commission going and they have figured out how to talk to the people in the Bloodskull Barony, and by people, I mean Orogs. So basically, they've discovered that there are runners that go back and forth between the camps, and they send messages. So their plan is to capture one of these messengers, give them our message, and send it on, and hope that something comes from it. So that's where we're at right now. I'm sure we're gonna have to deal with this at some point, but at least for the moment, we're still kind of making efforts, making strides on that. A really hilarious side effect to come from Roz now presenting as her true authentic self, which is female and not illusioning herself to look for an old man, is there are so many people looking for Roz, the old man. Not getting in trouble with people who he offended, not getting in trouble with dwarves who think that he stole their potion. Everybody's just looking for Roz and really working out for Rashida. Speaking of Roz/Rashida, she goes and visits the Smarty Pants gang to be like, hey, remember when I was Grandpa Roz? I'm just regular Roz now, I guess. Grandpa Roz really liked these kids. I'm not sure what Roz thinks of these kids yet, even though it's the same person, but it was different mentality, right? So anyway, while she's there, she finds that suddenly there's a new tiny hobbit that has joined the Smarty Pants gang, which is kind of weird because hobbits aren't super common, but you know, welcome. Here's some money for candy, I guess. And then we also got a letter back from King Bebenez? Bebening? Bourbening. I don't know what his name is. And he is from Hellscappa, so maps are great. I could zoom in, but I'm not going to. So this is us again, and I mean technically us because this is now Steward Vinnick. This is Hellscappa here. The king there was like, why did you send me this letter inviting me to a council for the Highlands that you've also invited the Siren to? And this is where the Siren lives, right there. You can just see that right there. Just kind of at the south of Hellscappa. And so, fortunately, Roz is really well-read, and so Roz knows the history. So there was an old Anshe who was in the territory that the Siren is now encompassing, who had that land and then started to go north into Hellscappa and take some of that land. Hellscappa, obviously not cool with that, went to war at the borders. Siren came along, destroyed that Anshe, took his land, but also kept the land that he had taken from Hellscappa, which Hellscappa not cool with. So we can see why Hellscappa and the king of that nation would be like, I'm not going to a meeting if she's gonna be there. Well, we also got a letter from the Siren saying, I'm not going to a meeting if he's gonna be there. So basically, Brindis took this time to send a strongly worded message to both of them saying, listen, we're trying to figure out how to make unity in the Highlands, and this summit would be the best place to do that because everyone will be here, it'll be impartial, maybe we can work out a solution here. And also we sent some troops up to the border of Steward Vinnick and Hellscappa, just kind of in the south, so, you know, kind of threatening, definitely threatening them. Well, we'll have to see what comes of that, but I'm sure Something will. So next, it's been a couple months and it is time for domain turns. We always let Brindis go first because sometimes she gives us money, which is nice, you know, salary for adventuring with her. So Brindis went first, and Brindis built a row from Iver to Hogenmark, so like north, just to, you know, start to be able to provide more resources to the area and infrastructure in general. I also think she tried to rule a province. I didn't write down which one it was. I'm gonna say Fremensky. I mean, technically that's the city, Namburg. I think that's what she tried to rule. It didn't work. Rainier decided to level up his hunting lodge, not the one that he built on Dantir Island, but he has one up in Lofkerdik, which is kind of in the north of the country, so that went well for him, so good job, Rainier. Roz made another ley line. So with ley lines, Roz gets regency from them, but also when she wants to cast big domain spells, she needs to draw from those provinces to do so. But it hasn't come up yet, so we'll see if it ever does. But now Roz has, I think, a source 22, which is pretty good, because I think most of the domain spells I have are, like, I don't know. I don't remember. I haven't cast them yet, but it's good to have that extra regency for the time when I do choose to cast domain spells, if it comes up to that. And I'm also trying to get kind of closer up to the White Witch territory, which is why I went into the Bloodskull Barony with this one, because she's evil and we're gonna have to fight her at some point, so it'd be nice to be able to draw some domain magic and cast some spells in her area. It'll make her super mad too, probably. Because Jan has been investing in Olaf's armaments, because they're making shotguns, well, muskets now, he invested more money to build a bigger warehouse because he's just running out of room in his current shop for that. And Val attempted to make a level 2 holding of her shipyard, but she failed. Meanwhile, during the domain turn, so during this month, remember when everyone was looking for Grandpa Roz? Well, one of them was the Freeman's Council, and Rashida's like, you know what, I knew Grandpa Roz pretty well. I'll come to your meeting. And they're just basically talking about all the new freemen because, you know, after we took over Ryuvik, so after we took over here and also went to Svinik, they didn't have freemen like we do. I mean, they had free men, but they didn't have protections and rights like ours do. Well, this council is talking about, what do we do about all these new freemen and who gets the right to vote? And now they're being a little elitist. They're like, well, if you're not like us and you can't read, you shouldn't get the right to vote. And Roz is like, oh, you're killing me, guys. Also, Olaf from Olaf's Armaments has finally got the first goon prototype, which is what we call guns because we're stupid and we call it goon pooter instead of gunpowder. And he can make them. It takes about 3 months to make each one, hence the need to, you know, get a bigger area to build because then they can maybe speed up production. Next, Jarl Andros from Iver, the guy that we brought down to get Iver back in shape, comes up and he's like, listen, we're making steps, but we still got stuff that we need to do, and I would really like to make military service compulsory because I think that will help with some of the discipline problems that we're having, and also, can I please have my troops, my personal troops, back in the city because I think they can help with the training. And we're like, yeah, we just sent them to the border of Hellscapa, but once we deal with that, absolutely, you can have them back. We do get a letter back from the Siren during this month, and she's like, you know what, I agree with you, I am willing to come to the summit and talk peace. And the king from Hellscapa is like, nah, I'm out. Ooh, you threatening me with your army, ooh. And then the Bloodskull Barony, we got our message through and they do agree to meet us just a little bit north of Vyborg, which is in Ryuvik, or former Ryuvik, to talk about peace. So, I mean, things are going pretty well, kind of. But before we go off to the summit, or before we go off to meet with the Bloodskull Barony, there's a few things that we want to take care of in Hogenmark. First of all, there's the Black House. So the Black House is on the river. We basically think it's a ship house. Boats go in. Nobody really sees boats come out. Jan and Stormholtzen have put spies on to try to figure out, you know, what's going on in this house. None of them have been successful. But at Brindis's wedding, her patron, who's a hobbit, gave her a note that said the Black House. So this is something that now Brindis's witchy patron wants her to look into, so we've decided we should maybe look into it. So we managed to sneak into it and we get inside and it's pitch black. There's nothing in there. There's no one in there. There isn't even cargo. It's very confusing, but we know that boats come in here, so like, what the heck? Roz does detect magic on the door, and they determine that the doors are magic, so this could potentially be some sort of portal. That's when I think somebody remembers that the boats that come in usually have runes on the front, and so we decide to stake out looking for a boat. So we get on the roof, and we wait, and we wait, and we wait, and a boat shows up, and we decide to just jump down to the deck, and it'll be fine. We jump down to the deck. It's not graceful for some of us, like Roz, no decks. But we get on the deck of the ship, and as the doors are opening, the captain's like, what are you guys doing here? Like, whatever, like, we probably don't want to be here, but sure, come on in. And so we go through the doors to the Black House, and suddenly the inside is completely different from what we had just previously seen. There's like skeletal zombie workers everywhere, there's cargo, and this guy, this captain, is here to drop off supplies here before continuing on his way. And presently we are in the Shadowland, and we are in Felvan City, so which is basically Hoganmark but in the Shadow World. We decide not to take the boat to leave because maybe this is where Brindis's patron wanted us to come to, so we decide to go check out the city, which, you know, once we start going, it's a little weird because everybody's dead slash half dead, and some skeletal guards come up to us, but Jan is able to scare them away with his charm aura thing, so they leave, but it's probably only gonna be a matter of time before they come back. I mean, there are other creatures here, but they're more like the hobbit variety and elven-like, not regular humies like us. Well, after we scare off those skeletons, suddenly Nettles, who is Brindis's patron, is there, and she's like, hey, come down here, come down here. And she says, listen, the Lord of Bones is creating a secret army here. Like, if you look over there, you can see it, maybe it's not so secret. And his intention is to invade the Land of Light, to invade Hoganmark and take over. You need to go take care of him, and once you do that, you know, you'll be safe. I mean, it seems like a good thing to do. I don't know if it's a good idea, but we decide to go do it anyway. In order to get to the castle though, we use a little bit of magic and various other disguises so that everybody thinks we're dead. And when we get to the castle doors, we say that we're petitioners because we hate petitioners, but we do know that castles tend to have petitioners, you know, gotta ask the lords and ladies and kings and queens stuff. So we get to the Lord of Bones and we start asking for stupid things like less zombie prostitutes and more of this and more of that. And he's basically telling us the opposite of everything. And so we're like, hey, you should make your army bigger, thinking that he'll say, hey, I should make it smaller. He's like, I should make it bigger. So that was a backfire. But Brindis decides to, you know, just get this going. And so she shoots the Lord of Bones in the face with her musket, which was a wedding gift from Jan, one for the king and one for the queen, because who are the social media influencers back in the day but the king and the queen? As soon as we start combat, Rainier goes and locks the door because we don't want the skeleton guards that we just passed coming in here. We just want to take out the Lord of Bones on our own. Obviously, the Lord of Bones is not happy that he just got shot in the face, and so we get into a battle, and because we locked the door, I think it made a big difference, and it went decently. Rainier did go down, but it's because Rainier is kind of a tank. He has this thing where when he's raging, it's disadvantage to hit all of his friends, but not him. And so he tends to get the most of the damage. But he goes down, but also so does the Lord of Bones, so that is awesome. We probably don't have to worry about the skeletal army invading the Light World anymore. Once that's all taken care of, the doors open up, and it's like, oh no, the skeleton guards are coming. But it was just Nettles. She shows up in her hobbit form, and as she's walking through the throne room, she transforms herself basically into a dark elf. So here she is. This is what your patron actually looks like, Brindis. And she basically says, hey, Brindis, you know, your payment to me is done with. We're good. And go back to Hollingholmen. So we get back to Hollingholmen, and it's time for a long rest because, like I said, Rainier went down and all of us took a little bit of damage. Jan and Brindis, because they both have these muskets, have decided to work on gun proficiency. So in order to build a new proficiency, you have to spend 10 weeks doing that. So that can be 10 long rests, or it can be like 4 weeks on your domain turn and then 6 more weeks somewhere. So they're slowly working on this, costs a little bit of money, but eventually you can get proficiency with that because right now it's just pretty flat. Rainier goes off to pit fighting because that tends to be what he does generally when we are doing long rests. and Val goes off to bounty hunt. And because Roz has somewhat stupid friends who like to get beat up all the time, she goes to make some potions because having a stash of potions is very necessary when your friends keep getting hurt. After the long rest, we decide it's time to go to the Ryuvik embassy because if anyone can deal with booby traps and all that stuff, it's us. And pretty much everything on the first floor is booby trapped in some way. There's arrows that will shoot when you open the door, there's poison doorknobs, there's nets that are covered with poison, left, right, and center. Everything wants to kill us. I mean, they obviously knew what they were doing when they were leaving. They knew we had declared war. They were making sure that anybody who came in here was going to have a problem. Fortunately, Jan and Val work together really well when it comes to looking for traps and checking for traps and disarming traps. So we managed to avoid all the traps, which was pretty nice. Until we got upstairs. Val checked. She didn't see a trap. So they went to unlock the door, open the door, and this huge flail comes down and knocks them both pretty hard. But you know, doing all right so far, all things considered. Then we get to this door, and Val had such an amazing perception check that somehow she saw that inside this room, like through the keyhole, there was a match attached to the doorknob that once you turned it, it would strike and something would probably light on fire. And so Brittany and Jan dimension door into the room and they find that the room is full of barrels of dwail that would have just completely blown up, probably would have killed us all. Fortunately, because we knew it was there, Jan, like I said, went in with Brindis and he was able to disable it from inside. There were a few more traps along the way and we get to the barracks and we notice that there is a dumbwaiter in the wall. But it's really interesting because in none of the rooms downstairs was there a dumbwaiter. So we decide to send some people down to see what's going on. And so the dumbwaiter goes down and it goes down and it actually goes into the basement. Jan and Val go down first together, and when they get there, they see a pretty basic basement. There's cots, there's maps, there's a hole in the wall that leads to the sewer, but oh wait, there's also 10 spies. So they yell and they start to fight, and then all of us go down there. Rainier drops down and like trips and falls, and it's not a graceful situation, but we all get down there, and we take out 9 of the 10 spies. Of course, the 10th we're leaving to ask questions to. And they are from the Scarlet Glove Assassins. They are spies from like the former Ryuvik and they're there. So they've just been infiltrating us this whole time. The spy that we questioned, he was like, are you gonna let me go? Or I think we said we'd let him go. And we actually did. We were nice. Bye-bye guy. But he did give us some very valuable information. And that's that the head of the Scarlet Glove Assassins is a guy named Rainier, not our Rainier, obviously. And he's based in Iver. So another problem we're going to have to deal with. But that was the end of that session. We kind of got a lot done. We went to a different world and we dealt with the stupid embassy and nobody died, which is always a win. If you enjoyed this episode, make sure you hit the like button down below and also subscribe so you'll know when the next one's coming out. And with that, I'll see you next time.